We forgot to tell you, Brian, too, that we have to do a little jig to the music.
Well, now that I'm on TikTok, I do a little bit more.
Oh yeah, you've been learning. That's right. I don't know any good TikTok moves. Although my daughter's not one. Hey, good morning, everybody.
Hey, gang. Oh, we have to do the Zoom.
Oh,
I'll
yeah.
I'll sub in for Brent.
Get that for me, yes. The high-tech special effect.
There we go. Hello, everybody. Welcome. Big hello to everybody in the chat. Kind of cool. See a few folks noting that they're actually from Ottawa. That's awesome. I'm coming at you from Eastern Ontario, outside of the Ottawa area today.
Oh.
And where we woke up to snow on the ground and frost and anger in the air, I'll tell you.
That's no good.
Nobody's happy. So.
Well, we have representation from the East Coast in the U.S. Mr. Mm-hmm. Brian Fanzo, how you doing this morning?
I'm doing pretty well. And when I saw the time of the show, I was like, wow, you guys are getting up early. I mean, this is, I'm a night owl, not a morning person. So this works good for me. I'm live and kicking here at 10 a.m. in Virginia.
And we, up until this past year, we were doing it at 9 a.m. So that was really harsh for Brent over out in Phoenix. So,
oh yeah.
He
5 a.m. wake up call.
Yeah. I'm ready for my close up, Mr. DeMille. Anyway, I'm ready for my close-up, Mr. DeMille.
I know. See the bags under my eyes? This is your fault, Chris.
Yeah, I know. I know. Friends and guests and everybody joining us in the chat today, thanks for joining us, obviously. As Brent said, we have Brian Fanzo with us here today. Brian, just give us a quick overview of who you are, where you come from, that kind of thing. I know you've been with us before, and some people might remember you from that, but let's... introduce yourself to all the new people.
Sure. So I'm currently a digital futurist, full-time keynote speaker, otherwise known as an unemployed keynote speaker, since there's no stages to be speaking on at the moment. Mostly doing all virtual event stuff at this point. But I background in computer science, worked for the Department of Defense in cybersecurity for about 9 years, deploying and managing cybersecurity tools focused around collaboration between different military branches. Left that world and actually took a job at a data center company out in Phoenix, Arizona, working for Brent, which seems like many, many years ago. Although those days were years in numbers on all the fun we had creating a training team, growing a training initiative in an interesting space from a data center, which was traditional real estate, and moving it into the cloud innovative space where we went from competing with just people that have been around for hundreds of years to competing with Amazon, Google, and Facebook, and trying to train not only clients, but a very interesting employee base. We were hiring 12 new hires a week for almost 2 years, which was, we lived the traditional startup world where free lunches and ping pong tables and open work environment and all of those things, which kind of grew into my role as a technology evangelist. And as that data center company was getting procured, I kind of ventured out on my own a little over 5 years ago. Did a little bit in like the marketing agency life, but about 60 times a year. And really my focus is the synergy between digital innovation and humanity and kind of figuring out how this whole digital virtual world works so that we can still be better humans and do the things that we need to do. So that's where I kind of come back from. My brand is iSocialFans, which is where you can find me on social, and my new speaker website, which is all virtual event content. I've done over 25 videos in the last 30 days on virtual event stuff, is brianfanzo.com. So excited to be back.
Very cool. Very cool. And you did mention, obviously, being unemployed currently because of the fact that, oh, you are a face-to-face person in terms of your previous or your business, your work going into this. And so we wanted to take this opportunity to talk about some of that stuff about transitioning from that kind of world, your experiences, et cetera, and then things that other people who might be facing something similar can maybe, learn from or gather up. And What was maybe the first thing going into this that you realized you had to do differently or learn or change?
So it was interesting, you know, for me, you know, I feel like speakers, we kind of got a head start because things started canceling in the conference space early on. And I mean, I remember I was in social media marketing world in San Diego. I was speaking on a Friday, talked to about 15 friends at a dinner, and there was only four of us that had an event postponed. That Monday at the end of the event, we all went out to dinner. There was only 10 of us at that time. And there was almost $250,000 worth of events that had been postponed. And it was kind of that quickly overnight. And between March 3rd and March 12th, I had 18 speaking gigs either canceled or postponed to the following year. All five of my full-time retainer clients that I've been working with on event speaking content, marketing, all terminated their contracts kind of overnight within a 24-hour period. And for me, you know, I went through the typical grieving period. I think that everyone had to, of like shock, disappointment, frustration, realizing that everyone's going through it. And, you know, the interesting thing for me was my model was always different. Like I used virtual digital social media to grow my speaking business, where most speakers had books, they used the stage or bureaus or agents to grow their speaking business. And so for me, this was my world. But although it being my world as far as live streaming, virtual and digital, I was always using it to grow something offline. And now the pivot is, okay, what does my product look like in a virtual space? Because it's definitely a shift in that mindset. And then also, you know, what does this all mean? And I think, you know, part of it has been, you know, how do you market and sell and connect in this world where we're all, you know, fearful of the unknown? We don't know what's going on. While at the same time, like, you know, I mean, and to be transparent, you know, 18 months ago, speaking business was taking off so much that I pretty much terminated all of my live video, like client work. I'd even when I migrated my website was like, I don't need that live streaming content. Like, no, who needs that? And so for me, like a lot of this pivot has been, hey, how can I, what is my role? And I can tell you, I defaulted to education. I felt like I've done over 3,500 live streams since 2014. I've launched massive brands onto both virtual and live content from IBM, Dell, Samsung, SAP, the Super Bowl, Applebee's, UFC. I helped all of them embrace Facebook Live, Instagram Live, influencer marketing. And so really to me, it was like, wait a second, what did we learn back then that I can now help with? And then even more so, because we don't know what the future or the unknown holds, what does this all look like? And so what I just decided was, I'm gonna act as if this is my everything at the moment. I'm gonna plan for 18 months of not speaking on a stage. And in 18 months, when the stages come back, I'm gonna have a very mature secondary income stream. And once I wrapped my head around that, it allowed me to stop being like, woe is me, I don't have the gigs and the stages, to, okay, let's attack this and do, you know, what I do in this space. So it's been, I will not hide the fact it's been a roller coaster. I think it has for everyone. And I would say my favorite thing right now, or not favorite, but the most common thing right now, is everyone wants to hurry up and run and launch something and create something. And then once you get to like right to that point where you're like, let's execute, let's pick a date, let's put a contract in, no one's ready to act. And so that's a little bit of frustration, but I think it has to do with kind of the landscape we're currently living in. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, frozen budgets will do that to department heads. Well, I'd love to do this with you, Brian, but I kind of have to wait until they say I can spend the money.
Oh, yeah.
So we talked about pivoting in sort of the description of having you on today. I mean, obviously, most of the people that are here that know you, that have followed you on social media and know everything that you share in that realm. Well, first of all, I thought it was really interesting when you contacted me and said, I'm going to go all in on the whole training, back to the training and the education side. And I kind of thought for a second, you know, it's interesting that you would say that, because you've been educating and training people anyways for so long. So you've been in it. You've just approached it from a business and an entrepreneurial perspective, like from that marketing side, which is why I've always talked about, and we've even had conversations here about how marketing is related to learning and training, and how the marketing departments and the training departments should get better connected and all that kind of stuff. But anyways, I'm getting off where I wanted to go with this question, but it was the pivot, right? Making right. that pivot and making that change. The thing that triggered me to reach out to you and want to have you back on the show was when you posted a video of how you completely reset up your studio in your office to embrace and to totally focus on this new direction and this pivot. Can you just kind of talk some folks through about what changed? Because you've always been on live. So right. everybody would just assume that you had the perfect setup. You were good to go. What made you all of a sudden think, I'm going to have to totally rethink my physical setup to make this happen?
So, you know, I think it's interesting that the way that you brought it into that, because I would say, and I think I've mentioned this on here before, you know, a lot of my success in the marketing space, the speaking space, even the digital innovation, the companies I've been working with, is rooted in the fact of my training, e-learning background, right? It's without question, people would be like, your perspective's unique. And I would always be like, oh, you know, I have a unique background or whatever it may be. But it was always because I came from it from, how can I help? What's the value? Like my tagline was show you care for years. And it was like, I'm going to care more, teach more, educate more, help people solve problems. And then they're going to use me as a trusted resource, right? And so, you know, I agree completely on the idea that like, it's been a fundamental core element. But I also think when you look at the world, I think this is something even in the learning space, when you look at budgets and the way people approach these different worlds, the fact that I've spent the last 4 years trying to convince people that online doesn't replace offline, but if you invest in it correctly and put the time and effort there, it will amplify, it will scale, and it will accomplish things that you could never accomplish offline. Well, all of a sudden, instead of me having to convince people that, they were forced it, which forcing change is never a good thing, we look at the world where we're at today. But because they've been forced there, not only do we have attention there, but we have like a new found approach. And so I think part of my pivot, part of like this adjustment for me was, not only can we not do the same old, but we almost have to go back to square one. Like, and I mean, the video I created this morning was that I think all virtual events are missing the mark on one key aspect. And it's that we're not educating the audience, because let's face it. I mean, I've signed up for 10 webinars in the last week. I plan on attending zero of them, right? Like I signed up so that I could get the download and get the email later on. And in this space, you know, that's such a disconnect. And I think as a speaker, one of the things that I take the greatest pride in is that when I get on stage, I have the greatest luxury in the world is I have the audience's captured attention for 30 minutes, 45 minutes, 60 minutes. In the online digital world, there is no such thing as captured attention, right? Distraction, mm-hmm. notifications, and we've almost built up a tolerance. Like we watch Netflix with our phone in our hand, right? We don't even, like our expectation and desire, you know, virtual consumption is such a different beast than what it is offline. So one of the things that I kind of went back to was, you know, a lot of the psychology element, like how do I convey different emotion through video? What is, if I'm doing a live video versus a pre-recorded video, what are the benefits of each? And then how do I make sure that I'm leveraging that? And I can tell you one of my biggest focus has been, you know, I didn't want to lose the value and the brand that I've been building for the last 5 years. And that included kind of my fee integrity in the sense of what I got paid. And so when I looked at that, I tested 68 platforms, 68 demo, and the blog post should be out Monday of next week. But and part of it was like, and Brent, you know me pretty well in this space. Like, I was like, you know what? I'm gonna be the most innovative, forward-thinking. But I don't have an ego. I didn't know what was out there. Like, what was the most, you know, innovative webinar platform? And like, if I believed marketers, which I don't, every webinar platform is innovative. Every web, you know, is bleeding edge. Is, you know, interactive. Is whatever the, you know. And so I did 68 total demos for everyone that was virtual event. And it was very selfish because I was like, I'm going to know what's out there. And then I'm going to know how I can leverage that best for me. And so that was part of why me redoing the office and the kind of like setup was, okay, Brian, even if you're the most innovative one in this arena, if it looks the same as what you weren't selling with a financial tag to it, because remember, that was what was the weird part for me was, people would, you know, they would see a live video and buy me offline. well, now I need them to see a video and buy me on video, right? Like, it's like, wait a second. Like, there has to be some a clear, you know, difference there. And so I've configured my office for a three camera shoot that I have three different cameras hooked up to my machine that I can interact with live. Each one has a different lighting setup, has a different background. The idea is, okay, what's my different emotion that I'm conveying? What is the different style of learning? I retooled all of my keynotes from 60-minute talks to individual 8-minute segments. So every 8 minutes, I'm prepared to change my viewpoint, change the style. I really hardcore went into, if I'm going to push the envelope, I want to know what's out there. I want to be able to respect and understand this. And then probably the most important one was, if I'm going to get that attention that one time from that audience, I want them to remember me, because I think that's where, you know, it's the hardest mark we're at right now. Is just, I still don't think, I've said this before, like e-learning and, you know, learning and development as a whole has been underfunded, especially in the internet world, was that it wasn't just because there's a YouTube video that can teach us. It was because we hadn't shifted all of our attention or resources or, you know, understanding. I mean, the fact we have a web camera shortage right now is just perfect proof of the fact that, like, what in the world's going on? And so that pivot has been a lot of adjusting. And I can tell you, even the way I package my product, like yesterday I had a 3-hour call with my team, my content team, my agent, and my assistant on, we have to repackage this. Like, the people that want what I have aren't ready for this, but they would love a turnkey solution. And I've been packaging it differently. And so I can tell you that, you know, if you asked me it took me a couple of weeks, let's say March 26th, what I was packaging and selling, it does not look anything like it does today on what, you know, April 22nd. And so it's been an evolution, but it's been fun for me to be able to show off those chops, like what I've been, my background. And I can honestly say, like, I mean, this is my favorite arena of all. Like, this, I mean, it really has kind of fell into my lap. Now the question is just how do you sell it and productize it and educate the audience?
Yeah. And your comment about, you know, watching TV and video with your phone in hand, Lynette, in the very, before we even started, said, I might try to stay up in Australia to watch us, but she's probably going to watch the recording. Eric made a comment earlier, even before you said that, about checking in from the Crowdcast mobile app today so I can move around the house. You guys look great, just a wee bit smaller. So, you know, all kinds of levels, even in our own audiences here. I mean, I'm betting lots of folks are running us right now, but also doing email and other, you know, things, et cetera, that kind of attention span. Let's maybe just talk a little bit about you, because what caught me a minute ago was when you said three different cameras. And depending on emotion, for example, and yeah. I mean, so many of us just think about turning on the thing that's on, you know, the little green dot on our laptop or whatever, and you know, away we go. Talk a little bit about how you're, I guess, using those cameras and that emotion, because it's all about connecting, really. It's about building something as a connection to be, you know, help shield against or help cut through the noise and the distraction.
So the thought I had was, you know, at first I look at technology and innovation, and I have more gear be sent to me than I know what to do with most of the time. But when it comes down to executing, like I have a ring light, a Logitech camera, and a microphone, right? I'm one of those that, like, I love to innovate and push limits, but if it doesn't have a purpose or a reason or a true advantage, I'm not going to use it. And so when I started thinking design the three camera piece and the emotion, one of the things that I really wanted to understand was, okay, what is the emotion I want to convey myself, like from me, but what is that reaction I want from that audience? And so the three that I have, is the first one is kind of inspiration. So you're seeing the inspiration. I'm standing, right? It's a standing shot. It's me with that background and really trying to be like, hey, this is me delivering what would be traditionally a keynote and very inspirational content. When I switch to the other camera view, I have a whiteboard, and I think of that much more on the education side. Like, come with me, let's get a little bit closer, let's get a little bit more intimate. And I have a camera on a whiteboard, and then I have an iPad that is also connected, right? So I can whiteboard and kind of really bring that in. And then the third camera is what I call participatory, right? So when I go to Q&A, when I'm Q&A like this, it's intimidating. Like, I don't want to ask that guy questions. But when the Q&A is like, you know, at this point with an all black background, lighter lighting on my face, a microphone that I'm actually holding, so they see, hey, Brian's ready to talk to us. Like, it's not like, oh, we have, you know, like that distance. And so that's the three. And I can tell you the big piece of that is how do I want them to feel? And even to that point I was saying before is, how do I make sure that I'm doing my part to make that possible, right? And so, like, I mean, it's funny when someone interviews me and I'm sitting down, their whole dynamic to me is different. And even though I'm this passionate and this loud, no matter what I'm doing, a lot of it is, okay, how do I shift that and bring them in? And, you know, and part of it too is, like, I'm a team of one. Like, there's no remote producer. This is Brian. And so I also want to make it kind of to show, like, I'm putting in the effort to really make this virtual experience worth your time. I hope you get my time, right? Like, you know, like, you give me your time. And I think that's such a, that's part of this process, is that it's great for us to say, please don't multitask. This is an engaged presentation. We're going to be interactive. It's, you know, we care about everybody. But then if you're screaming for 40 minutes and you open up questions for 8 minutes and you're like, I think there's some questions, you know, like, that there's such a big disconnect in how we, you know, what we're saying. And so that's where I focus the three. I mean, even to the point where I changed the lighting, because one of them I had tested out with non-marketer, non-speakers. And they're like, Brian, it's great, but it's still a little like, and I was like, oh, so you want me to, and so I went and bought light bulbs that had a kind of a different ambiance that's like, hey, come have a conversation with me. And it really, it does change that dynamic. And so that's where I thought of that. You know, and I think emotion, like, we talk about empathy a lot, right? But, like, yeah, understanding the emotion we convey, the emotion we want to generate, and then how do we connect the two, right? Like, that's that beauty, right? And for me, that's, to me, the most important aspect of this type of virtual content, if you're doing it live, right? I think one of the things that I've heard a lot from my clients is that, you know, there's those three types of video, live, pre-recorded, and produced. And I say those three, like, I'm using those three, like, that's the three I'm focused on. Yeah. But that live one, when it's high production, high quality, is really where the money is at for me, right? So, like, that's when someone's gonna pay me top dollar. And funny enough, that's where I'm most comfortable, right? And, like, and that, there's an interesting shift there. But, like, just because it's live doesn't mean it can't be strategic. Just because it's live doesn't mean you're talking to a camera and give your 60-minute keynote. That's called YouTube. Just go watch that on YouTube. Stop doing that here, right? And I mean, I did an event last Wednesday, and every 8 minutes, over a 60-minute spot, every 8 minutes completely changed how I was presenting. I went from, you know, this kind of video to, I did a Prezi presentation next to me that was interactive graphic, to I went and sat down until I had the whiteboard over full screen and I was a little circle in the corner. And, you know, every 8 minutes I changed, which kind of not only gives that audience that, like, what's coming next, but, you know, in my opinion, it kind of allows them to see, hey, there's different learning opportunities here available.
Mm-hmm. It's like you've taken the extra time to think about this like a television production studio. Yes. Almost, or a director framing or thinking about how to frame shots and the value or the way that framing then influences how we, you know, emotionally respond to, yes, to things. Yeah, very cool. Which is beyond what most of us, you know, are able to do. Yeah, you know, most of us have that one little camera, maybe,
right,
you know, but still thinking about even how to use that gives us a sense of maybe for better, sure, ways that we can make something more communicative or more connectable to people.
Yeah, and more effective. We have two, right? We have the one, yeah, on our computer and our phone, right? And I think that's a, you know, important one as well, because, you know, even if you think about it from, like, a Facebook Live, and when someone is like, you know, or Instagram Live, right? I've been working with some musicians recently, and they only like Instagram Live. And to me, it was such a weird, like, why? Like, what? They wanted all these features. I'm like, it's on Facebook. It's owned by the same company. And a lot of what they would say was, it's not the same intimacy. Like, for them, the phone leaning up against the guitar case and them playing, to them, lets them feel like people are backstage. Mm-hmm. Them having a web camera and a 3-video shoot is, they're doing an online concert. And like, the more you think about that, the more it is like, oh, wow, like, I feel like you let me into your living room versus you're just broadcasting your message out, and like that kind of different dynamic. And so I can tell you the thing I'm testing later today, which will be interesting. So I have a 360 camera. I don't know if you can see it here. I have a 360 camera that I've been using a lot recently. And so I've created a tripod with the 360 camera and my iPhone attached to the same tripod, because one of the talks I'm giving is about pressing the damn button and creating video and documenting video. And so during my live session next week, hopefully, I want to walk out of my office down the stairs out in my front yard with the, you know, the mobile phone as the virtual camera and the 360 camera to provide that second view and kind of show them, hey, this is my thought process. This is how I get to it. And if you think about it, like, I'm literally taking you out of my office, out the front door. And I'm, you know, for me, that's part of it. Like, in the virtual space, we have the ability, like, I truly think the only limitations in virtual are our creativity. Like, I don't think there's very, you know, like, other than the fact I can't shake your hand and I can't, like, shake you to please watch this. Like, I mean, for the most part, you know, the opportunity to, you know, and most of the tech, for those that, like, some of this times, like, oh my goodness, all the tech you're using, like, this isn't a very tech heavy operation, right? I can tell you, like, it's two web cameras and a GoPro. I have a DSLR camera. I've had camcorders before, but for me, it was like, okay, what can perform this without breaking my machine? I don't need to buy a second machine. I don't need two KVM switcher. I mean, Brent and I have bought more gear at the job that we had to put on live streaming and all these different things. And like what I would do for like that TriCaster that we had, oh, that was the greatest. But I also like, that's part of it as well, is right, is the, I went high production level, but I also am not trying to make this complicated for complicated sake. And it's, if the tech is taking away or too distractive, it does actually more harm than good. And so, and I'm studying live broadcasts. I can tell you the places I'm studying the most right now, documentaries, live TV, Twitch, and TikTok. And if you, I mean, TikTok average user, 54 minutes on the app per day.
Yeah.
Ridiculous. TikTok or Twitch, most engaged video gaming community in the history of the world. People will watch 3 hours of someone sitting in a chair playing a video game. Like I've spent, I mean, I'm not a gamer at all, zero gaming ability or, but I've spent easily 60 hours watching Twitch since coronavirus. And it was, I mean, I've done document, like, how does this, like, what questions is he asking the audience? How is he previewing what he's doing next? How does he stay focused on his content while giving people, like, and like, it's funny, like they'll switch the view of their camera when they're in game mode. And then when they're like, oh, I got this, you'll see them switch again. And like from the novice, you're just like, you know, like, hey, they're, you know, they're that's just what they're doing. But there's 4,000 people that are commenting so fast, the comments are moving, right? And I think if we look at those kind of examples and learn from them, we'll be able to do virtual rather than like, let's look back at like the most innovative webinar. Like someone asked me that the other day, what's the most innovative webinar you've ever been on? I was like, I haven't cared to research that. And they're like, what do you mean? Like you're doing innovation in virtual. And I'm like, I am. And I'm not going to go back and look at history to figure out where the future of a space that has never been relevant, you know, in this area. So it's,
yeah,
it's fun to study that kind of environment.
We had a study and I we've lost track of it, but internally in our own dev team, there was a study that was being floated around and quoting as we were working on like software screen captures and stuff like that, that showed that in the gaming world, if the gamer person is, you know, the little face is inset inside the video, that actually increases engagement levels and people stay longer than if it was just the screen of the video and the person talking, just having that face live in there. And so that's been an influence on our own thinking, that just that little extra bit of human connection, the facial emotions, even if that's not the subject, because it's down in the corner, it's small, sort of tucked away, but it's there. And then last couple of days ago, I went down a rabbit hole looking at some product stuff in the music world, one synthesizer stuff, and came across a guy who was doing he did an hour and 20 minutes or an hour and 15 minutes review of a tool. And I finally left because I was falling asleep because it was late in the evening. But what he had was, because the tool was on his table and he's looking down at it, but he had a round mirror off to the side, which was basically pointing at the camera and his face. So you were watching him as he tweaked. It wasn't multi-camera. It wasn't like, it was literally just like almost like a makeup, you know, or a shaving kind of mirror, like that kind of thing. But you're watching him think and talk. And he wasn't having to even go away and remix or cut two videos together or anything like that. It just sitting on his workbench as he and the camera then was the other camera was the main camera. Actually, the only camera was shooting down, but it was capturing his face in the mirror as well as his hands on the thing.
Yeah,
it's just like, that's like a $5 hack, you know, versus. Anyway, and this fellow is successful enough that not only does he do these things, but he's got like four different website or four different t-shirt lines that you can purchase while you're watching his YouTube videos. So anyway, a couple of like it doesn't take a lot necessarily equipment wise, maybe if we just think about what we're trying to accomplish. In that case, it's the human connection while, you know, you're exploring a machine, for example.
Exactly.
Yeah. Speaking of gear and whatnot, Brian, I know you've got a gear page on your website. If you want to drop that in, because I know we got a lot of gearheads that jump into the chat and everybody always wonders, how does he do that? What does he use? And you've mentioned a lot of the stuff, but I'll bet they would love to have a link to your resource, because I've been there plenty of times trying to check out what's Brian using these days. Let me just go to check his website real quick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Go ahead, Brent. Oh, I was just going to say, there is a question too in the question. I don't want us to forget. It's about your decision around 8 minutes. You've mentioned 8 minutes a couple of times. Where did that come from? What's the idea behind that too?
So the average watch time of webinars that included video in 2019 was 9 minutes. And so for me, when I looked at that, I was like, average watch time of someone that started the webinar at the beginning, right? So not total amount of time, but like those that are watching, like what's the average watch time? And so for me, it was like, okay, 9 minutes in, what is like, what, you know, if nothing's changed or what, you know, like the content hasn't connected. And so that's where that 6 to 8 minute mark. And it also, I mean, I've spent more time retooling my content and dry running the gear than I have for any keynote I've ever gave on any main stage. Like it's, I mean, I spend, 5 hours multiple times on just, okay, here's this content in an 8 minute chunk, and I deliver it, and then I put it against like what I would have done, you know, elsewhere. And I'm really hardcore reviewing, like, what is the takeaway? What's the emotion? If someone only watched that, what did they feel? What, you know, where do they go from there? And so I'm really working hard on that piece of it. And so, yeah, the 8 minutes was originally triggered by that study, that, you know, 9 minutes of watch time at the beginning. And then also there was, you know, for me, there's an element of, you know, I don't think, you know, we hear all the time, like, what's the perfect length of a live video? Or what? There's no perfect length. Like if you aren't boring, you people know what to expect and you're keeping them engaged, they'll watch forever. Like to your point on that, you know, on the video that you were watching. But I also think there's an element of just human psychology and what, how do we interact? And, you know, the other thing that I've been studying, so like the CNN has been doing the town halls, the Facebook town halls on Thursday nights with Sanjay, not a political statement, more of understanding what, and, you know, they're bringing in, you know, they had Anderson Cooper center stage, and they're bringing in these giant video screens on the side. And one of the things that I, just being the geek, I was like, I thought it was interesting. They're doing narrow video and showing from like belly button up, versus what we had always seen traditionally when someone was brought in was the tight camera shot. And so I actually reached out to a friend of mine that works at CNN who connected me with one of their directors. And one of the things that they said was when they were transitioning from like out of the studio and bringing someone in, the idea of showing someone interacting in 3/4 of their body helped people feel as though it wasn't much different than them being at home, right? So their whole desire was, we don't want people to feel like this is a online production, but we also don't want to like hide the fact that people are coming in virtually. And so they kind of came in between the two and said, we'll show that shot. And so to me, I started thinking about that from a learning perspective, a virtual perspective, you know, even the way that I'm showing my whiteboard now, you know, the angle that I'm bringing that in, you know, there's almost this like, okay, if I want people to feel like they're sitting next to me or they're part of something, you know, how do you change that dynamic? Which, you know, I think is, you know, another layer of fun. And, you know, and there's also, you know, even from a gear perspective, right? The idea if I have like AirPods in or I'm wearing a headset versus nothing versus like, I mean, I have a lavalier mic, which is the one I use when I walk around. And like the reason I said I'm using a handheld for part of it is I want people to see like I'm stopped because, you know, I have a problem stopping talking, which we all know. I'm stopping what I'm doing. I'm showing a, you know, a verbal, you know, hey, this is my hand motion. I'm gesturing to you like, hey, what do you guys have to say? And just that little, you know, those little things will ultimately get people to feel a little bit differently, shift in their chair. And I mean, that's one of the things that I've, you know, I kind of love testing. And even the reason I went with the GoPro and, you know, like the gear that I'm using, part of it has been, which gear gives me that kind of shot, and at the same time, show the environment that also conveys the emotion, right? Because it's not only what we say, our actions like this, it's also like, what is the environment they're a part of? I mean, if we can see here for a second, like, so like I have, you know, like this is my throw pillow environment, where it's, you know, these are pillows actually that I kickstarted a long time ago with us, you know, Steve Jobs, ICO. But you know, like for me, when I go to a shot with that, having people talk about the pillows, having people generate that conversation, okay, well, that's a different emotion, right? And so like I've been training some executives on being better on the virtual conference calls. And part of it was, don't just be like, hey, we're gonna have hat Thursday. When you get on Thursday, make sure that it's a different view, it's a different feeling, right? If you really want to change that dynamic, you have to physically do it, and you have to do it in every way, you know, every way possible. And interestingly enough, the people that do that best are those on TikTok right now, right? They're like, the average TikToker is putting their camera on like the floor against like a soda box, and they're dancing, right? Like, and you're like, why would they like if you think about it, like we've had Snapchat where we've, you know, been like this, we have Instagram stories, we have vertical video, but like in that TikTok world, the idea of dirty laundry or, hey, this is just me dancing in my living room, it's not like, hey, TikTok's dancing in your living room. You actually show your living room. Like, it's like, it's that dynamic. And I think it's important for us in the business space to understand and respect that as well. And I felt like, you know, CNN, both CNN and then the like Adobe and Salesforce, a couple of those big brands have done an amazing job of like allowing, you know, giving their people on virtual the ability to be themselves, but also, you know, high quality, not, you know, there's a difference between being sloppy and being yourself, right? And like, there's definitely, you don't want to, you know, we're not staging dirty laundry. I'm not saying that side, but there is definitely that element. I think part of it comes down to having the right shot and the type of shot so that you can kind of take advantage of that.
Mm-hmm. I was reading an article last night, a promo piece about a new book that's coming out that talks about the merger of, or the acquisition of Instagram by Facebook and the fallout, because in 2018, the two original Instagram CEO head guys left, and the sort of background culture to why all that came up. And one of the small pieces in this review of the book noted that the Instagram teams kind of realized after a while that because they were doing so much curation, that their own personal tastes in terms of the things that make good Instagram, you know, videos ended up leading to people imitating that, and therefore a very specific Instagrammy kind of appearance that kind of permeated then all Instagram posts, etc. Which is interesting because now, you know, you're talking about TikTok being, you know, it's a different app, and then people are doing things, you know, differently. But the that world of Instagram perfection, for instance, whereas right. TikTok has that, as Chris Carell is noting in there, the authenticity is a different tone. It's a different connective thing.
Well, you know, I think times have changed too, right? Like when Instagram was there, it was a filtered life, and we didn't have a filtered life. And I would still think online was what we told people we wanted them to think about us. And over the, you know, if you think about it from 2010 to 2017, all of a sudden authenticity became more important. Before it was like, don't talk about mental health. Don't you dare bring that up. Like, don't share this about, like, I mean, I remember there was even a point where people are like, I think you bring your kids up too much. Like, if you're talking about that much of being a dad, like how much time do you have spent working on your clients? And I was like, wow, like, you know, this is 2015. But you know, if we look at it now, it's, you know, so I think that's part of it too, right? Like we've matured. We've also had a newfound respect. Like though, you know, the idea of selling unicorns and rainbows and faking it online still exists, but we're slowly pushing them away. We're showing, you know, authenticity. And I agree, TikTok, I mean, the access to people, the types of conversations, and the willingness to be vulnerable is something I feel like we as a culture need. And TikTok has been pretty amazing at that. And I think we could, I've been studying TikTok, not because I want to be a TikTok star, but because I believe that trend can transform our business models moving forward.
Mm-hmm. So many places where we can go to look for other influences, et cetera. But at the same time, as your hat says, push the damn button. For those of us who are trying to switch into this world, moving from being, you know, face-to-face live people into this virtual kind of place, just start doing it, I guess, would say
sure.
I would say would probably be the starting point, but then do it and then take your own learning time to go and look at other models and other things too, for sure.
Yeah, I have a book on my coffee table that is for me taking notes during Netflix. Yeah. And I'll be like, wow, I couldn't look away. They switched the camera angle four times there, like, you know, like in a documentary. And I'm like, okay, what was that? Why did that have me feeling like that? Or, you know, even things like, one of my favorite things to study, and I'm kind of a geek for that, is like, I'll read the preview of a new show or something that's on and use what their thumbnail is. And I'll write down the three things I'm expecting. And then I'll watch it and I'll ask myself, did those three things happen? Maybe they did, maybe they didn't. And then if they didn't, why were they getting me to feel that way? Was that their way of roping me in to watch it, right? Like, and I think if we think about this world of disconnection, and, you know, we talk about like YouTube with thumbnails and titles, I think we sometimes over calculate that, but other times I think we have to look at ourselves, right? And like, you know, beyond pressing the damn button, it's like, what things do I relate to? Why do I relate to them? And how can I integrate that into myself?
I think a lot of people do expect, like, when you think about it, when we talk about how marketing influences what we do, and one of the exercises I've told people to do, and it's strange, I guess, to do it in learning and a training and development world, but because I was told to do it in school, learning about media in general, but take your favorite 30-second commercial, right? In 30 seconds, right? Marketing people have figured out the proper edits to get a particular feeling, right? All that kind of stuff. And yeah. I think people get it in their head after watching it. They think they've seen a whole boatload of video shots and everything. And I'm like, you've got a rewind button and a fast forward button. So record your favorite commercial and literally go slow motion or whatever you want to do and count every edit, right? And then come back and tell me that it really was a complicated thing. Yeah, they had to shoot a whole bunch of stuff to get it down to that. But people are like, you ask them ahead of time, how many shots do you think it took to tell that story? Oh, 25, 30, whatever. And then they go back and count and it's like 5.
Or even go back and like track the colors they use, the font type that they use, right? Like there's like, you know, like Reese's, there was an article recently, I think it was an Ad Week, about Reese Cup and how like Reese's has had like 13 marketing companies. Everyone wanted to change the font on the Reese's. And every time they're like, this is a non-negotiable. Yeah. And like, they're like, they look at it like the fact that they held true to that all these years, that's the reason that every competitor in like the peanut butter cup space fell off, was that you didn't go and buy a peanut butter cup. You went and bought a Reese's, even if you were buying the competitor. And a lot of it came down to type, you know, font type and colors and those things. So I think it's, you know, it's such an important thing to look at. And right now in virtual, just because we're consuming more on device, on screen, doesn't mean we have more attention or more time. And so I think that's such an important piece too, is like, okay, what has worked? What is currently working? What are people watching? Even like if you scroll through Netflix, I'll keep using Netflix, like they all of a sudden made like their titles vertical and longer, right? With like more space, right? And like all of a sudden, like the name of the show cares a little bit less and it's more like the DVD cover, where before, if you remember, it was like a slice of the DVD cover, giant title and description. And I mean, there's no mistaking that Netflix, I mean, they grow 48 million users just in the last month. I mean, like there's some science between those different pieces as well.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Chris, I think we normally go about 45 minutes or so, but this is awesome conversation. I want to keep it going, but one thing I don't want to forget, and I want to either ask our members in our chat to do this for us, or if you guys can do this, is let's do a quick selfie of the screen real quick so everybody can share what's going on, and I'm going to move my microphone. So will somebody count down like 3 seconds, and then we'll all smile at the exact same time.
3, 2, 1. Let's do some. All righty.
Just had to do that, you know. Yep. And we keep forgetting to do it when we're in the green room. So it's like, oh, well, just do it live. What the heck?
Well, someone asked a question about Vine versus TikTok. And just real quickly, the thing that I found, like, so I interviewed 28 TikTokers that were in an industry that you wouldn't expect. So nurses, doctors, lawyers, police, military, teachers. And the most common thread was they got on TikTok and realized they could find their people. They never considered themselves a creator or a storyteller. Then they realized they had a story to tell and but they didn't have to talk. So they could use video and use other people's clips and other songs, which then got them used to being on video, so that all of a sudden on their 40th video, they were more comfortable delivering it. And so the thing that I've learned from that, I think it's something we can learn across, is that most of us don't consider ourselves a creator, but we all have a story to tell. And so how do we shrink that gap? How do we enable those with great stories to feel comfortable enough to do it? And I think what Vine didn't do, what YouTube is even struggling with, right? YouTube rewards and favorites those that have been doing it for the longest time with all the right things. Vine started to reward those with like stopgap animation and those that were doing outlandish things, not making that a very easy path to get on. But the, you know, on TikTok, it's, I mean, right now for me, that over 30 hashtag is like the, all of my content is people over the age of 30. And it is so much fun because it's not, I'm not looking at younger people doing things, but I'm being exposed to people that, you know, look like me, act like me. There's a lot of those narratives. And I think we can learn from that piece of it as well. So I don't think, I loved Vine. I thought Vine had some value, but if we look at the path to success, it's how do we empower these great storytellers to put themselves out there? And you do have to make it an easy process to make that happen.
I'm going to start the over 50 hashtag. Who's with me?
It's booming.
Over 50. Good. Okay.
I think it has like 2.5 billion uses. I mean, I'm talking, yes. I mean, it's, you'd be amazed.
Those are my people. Oh man, this has always been a ton of fun, as it always is, Brian. It's so good to hang out with you. Thanks for joining us and agreeing to jump in here with us. Really do appreciate it.
Yeah,
it's a lot of fun. And like I said, you know, part of the reason for me going, like, you know, when I reached out, and part, you know, like, I think when we look at this education, we look at, you know, the bringing people on a journey, I would say like part of the unknown now is not as much, you know, hey, your job is being replaced by technology, but you have to upskill and you have to figure out a path to get you to where, you know, we are all going as a society. And like my, like, you know, soapbox at the moment has been like, we have like the coolest opportunity ever if we switch our perspective, that we're not going to go back to normal. Like that's not happening. But we've never had the ability to shape the new normal. And we each individually have that opportunity to decide what we prioritize, what we learn, what skills we make, you know, apparent to us. And so I look at it and say, like, hey, if each one of us take, you know, educating each other, lifting each other up, but also take our own part in making the world that we want to live in, the world we want to raise our kids in. And I look at it so much in this like education. And I mean, for me, it's been, I spend all my time really just trying to help people see what I've seen to do. And part of that is because I truly do think we can lift, you know, all the boats with, you know, all tides rise. And, you know, I love coming on and talking with you guys, and we'll have to do it again in a month, because I bet you lots of things can change all over again.
See what's different in a short period of time. Hey guys, in addition to lifting all boats, let's lift our coffee mugs and we'll dance on out of here today.
Indeed.
Cheers. Brian, thanks good so luck much to everybody. Always. Thanks to everybody in the chat. Some great comments going on in there too. Brent's looking for the music.
Try to hit this. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
There it is. And we'll be back here next week, everybody. We can promo that too. So we're going to have a good time next week. Same time, same bet channel, all that fun stuff. And you guys definitely reach out to Brian and engage with him. He's super fun to connect with and to hang out with. So we love having him back. And I'm going to hold you to that 1 month time frame there, Brian. So we'll have you back. We'll do it again.
Thanks, everybody. Talk to you all soon.
Adios. Cheers. Here comes the high-tech special effects.